Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to another episode of Spotlight Tribute here on the Heavy Hitter Network. I'm your host, Mario Romanelli. This is week 3 of October, meaning episode 3 of our tribute to Creedence Clearwater Revival. The first two episodes have been really, really good. I've got great feedback on that, and it just makes me excited to be back doing this show. So, like the first two shows, we're going to play a lot of good CCR music. We're going to be featuring a lot of great cover artists while doing it. And while doing it, we're also going to be throwing in some little nuggets, facts, hopefully some interesting stuff that you didn't know about the songs that we are about ready to play. So don't go anywhere. Let's get into it real quick. Before we do, let me just remind you guys, if this is your first time checking us out, thank you. And secondly, if you have not yet subscribed to our channel, definitely go do that. We are on YouTube by searching Heavy Hitter Network, or go to rumble.com and search HHNetwork. You can also go on the Facebook group page, which is also HHNetwork. And then the rest of our social media contacts will be right below the video in the description box. So I will not bore you with all of that. All right, with that out of the way, let's get to the show. First song up on this episode is Looking Out My Back Door. This is Alexander Jean doing the cover. This song itself was released back in 1970 on July 25th. This comes off the Cosmos Factory album. And I'm going to tell you right now, if not every song, almost every song tonight is coming off the Cosmos Factory album. So get ready for that. Like every other song that we've basically done by CCR, every original song at least, they're all written by John Fogerty and produced by John Fogerty as well. So that's funny. Also, don't forget, before I get too far, we do have another bonus video tonight, and it's a really good one. So I hope you guys will wait and check that one out as well. I'm not going to give it away, but it'll be worth the wait. Let's put it that way. As far as this song goes, this, again, made it to number 2 on the Billboard Hot 100. What song kept this off of the number 1 spot? Ain't No Mountain High Enough by Diana Ross was the number 1 song, while Looking Out My Back Door was number 2. So if you guys are just tuning in, the running joke here is that CCR never had a number 1. They had a bunch of number 2s. Never had a number 1 hit, believe it or not. So now it's kind of becoming fun to find out, okay, who held them off the number 1 spot this time. So, like I just said, this time it was Diana Ross with Ain't No Mountain High Enough. The lyrics of the song have people thinking two different things here. The first thing they think is the song is talking about drugs with a mention of flying spoons and the talk of seeing happy creatures dancing on the lawn. Kind of sounds like somebody might be tripping on some LSD or who knows what kind of drugs back then. John Fogerty, however, said in an interview the song was actually written for his 3-year-old son, which would make sense with the reference to the Giants doing cartwheels and tambourines and elephants are playing in the band. However, the line "Forward Troubles, Illinois, Lock the Front Door, Oh Boy" would not seem intended for a children's song. So, you guys make up your own mind of what you think this song is about. Either way, it did end up being a hit for CCR. So let's now take a look at the cover. And I'm telling you, this one, very quick, but I had to put it on here. And I will tell you, on the next episode, we do have a longer version, cover version of this song. But I like this cover so much, I was like, I gotta put it on. And it's very short, very quick, but very good by the cover artist here. And what I like about this, like a lot of CCR songs, everybody covers them. But it's just so simple. It's just so raw. But it's so good. So let's get to it now. Here we go. Alexander Jean doing Looking Out My Back Door.
Do, 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 looking out my back door. Do, 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 looking out my back door. Just got home from Illinois. Locked the front door, oh boy. Got to sit down, take a rest on. sitting. Pretty soon I'm singing. Do, 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 looking out my back door. Tambourines and elephants are playing in the band. Won't you take a ride on the flying spoon? Do, 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 wonder separation provided by magician. Do, 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 looking out my back door. Do, 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 looking out my back door.
All right, so there that was. Great cover. I really enjoyed that one by Alex Jean, and I hope you guys did too. Like I say, really simple, almost appeared like they're just in their backyard jamming out to that song. Did it really quick. Too quick. They left me wanting more because I loved her voice. She did a great job with that, and just the speed of it, everything. They just really did a great job, so I definitely wanted to put that somewhere on the series. And like I say, I snuck it into this one. So next episode, we will have another version of that song, a longer version, but definitely wanted to somehow get that one into the series. So glad I did. Hope you guys enjoyed that. Let's move on to the next song. And I did say real quick, I did say with that song that people were confused and had two different meanings for what they thought that song was about. That actually happens a lot with CCR music for some reason. I don't know why. A lot of people thought they were making a lot of protest songs to the war. Some were, some weren't. So it's just kind of weird. CCR, the way Fogerty wrote, must have confused people, or I don't know. People thought deeper about his writing, something. But a lot of songs that CCR wrote, a lot of people took different meanings out of them. So for whatever reason, I don't know. Next song up, also off of Cosmos Factory. Like I said, I think almost every song, if not every song, on tonight's show coming off that album, which tells you just how good that album was. But this one, not written by John Fogerty. This one was actually written by Norman Whitfield and Barrett Strawn. And there's a whole lot of twists and turns to this song. The song, heard it through Grapevine. Okay. Originally, this song was supposed to be written for the Isley Brothers. For whatever reason, some people believe that the session was canceled, whatever. Maybe they had something come up. Isley Brothers never ended up writing it. Recording it, excuse me. So, next was The Miracles. In 1966, The Miracles recorded it. They were getting set to put it out as a single. They got blocked by Berry Gordy, who was then the head of Motown Records. So, they did not put it out. In 1967, a year later, Marvin Gaye actually recorded his version, and he also got blocked by Berry Gordy from releasing it. Later that same year, 1967, Gladys Knight and the Pips recorded their version of it. Finally, Berry Gordy allowed it to be released. Kind of crazy. It still did come out on a album of Smokey Robinson and the Miracles later on, but just kind of weird that they weren't allowed to release it as a single. And why Berry Gordy continued to block it, I don't know. I know with the Miracles, he just felt like it wasn't a strong enough single. With Marvin Gaye, I don't know if it was the same thing or not. But then eventually to let Gladys Knight and the Pips do it, I don't know. Kind of weird. But either way, it did end up being a hit. For Gladys Knight's version of it, it reached number 2 on the Hot 100 in 1967. A year later, Marvin Gaye released it, reached number 1. In 1976, CCR did their version. They reached number 43. And in 1981, Roger Troutman along with Zapp released theirs, and they reached number 79 on the Hot 100. They did reach number 1, however, on the R&B charts with it. So it still did very, very well all the way up to 1981 with Zapp and Roger. So there's the long story of that one. And who knew? I never knew that song was supposed to be released by so many different people. And I just figured Gladys Knight and the Pips was the original ones that it was supposed to go with. And I always love hearing those stories about, nope, actually, that was supposed to be an Isley Brothers song. It's like, wow, never heard of it or never thought of it. But when you hear it, it would make sense. That does seem like something the Isley Brothers would have put out. So, kind of cool. All right. Another little fact about this one is basically the song is written, of course, about a guy that's kind of learning that his girlfriend cheated on him, and he heard it through the grapevine. Here's another little fact I never knew. The phrase grapevine is associated with black slaves during the Civil War who had their form of telegraph through the human grapevine. I never knew that. So hopefully you guys learned something out of all that. That's why I like doing this show. I learn as I go. And hopefully you guys do too. Now, let's learn who's doing the cover of this one. It's his second time in the series of CCR. The first time he rocked it out, did a great job. I'm expecting the same now. Doing, I heard it through the grapevine, Mr. Adam Pearce. Mr. Adam Pearce doing his cover of I Heard It Through the Grapevine. I thought he did a great job. I like his voice a lot, especially for CCR, because he's kind of got that raspy John Fogerty type voice. So it works out very well. He does a great job, though, too. So very talented cover artist there. Definitely go check out his work on YouTube. All right, next one we got here is Who'll Stop the Rain? And I told you that a lot of people get the meaning behind certain songs wrong. And this is one of them. This is another one. Another one off of Cosmos Factory. Another one released in 1970. Another one written and produced by John Fogerty. You kind of see the recipe for success, though, don't you? John Fogerty, definitely a recipe for success. And I cannot wait for you guys to see the bonus footage tonight that I've got, because it really does tie into John Fogerty. So definitely worth waiting for. This song, guess what? Peaked at number two. I bet you didn't know that. John Fogerty actually performed this song alongside Bruce Springsteen at the Creedence Clearwater Revival Hall of Fame induction. A lot of people have covered this song, especially two major country artists, Garth Brooks and Dwight Yoakam, both have covered this song. And here we go. Here's a story about this one that people get wrong. Some people believe this song was another protest to the Vietnam War. However, according to Song Facts, Fogerty told a crowd at an Arizona State Fair in 2012 the song was written about his experience at Woodstock, watching the rain coming down and all the concertgoers muddy, naked, and cold, all out dancing together. John Fogerty can be heard on a video where he performs this song on his YouTube channel, where he does mention the creation of this song does stem from his Woodstock experience. So again, this one had nothing to do with the war. It wasn't a protest song, and it was simply about his experience at Woodstock. So, don't know if you guys knew that, but now you do. So, let's check it out. Doing the cover on this one, Margot Cotten. And I will tell you, Margot Cotten does a lot of CCR covers. So if you do like this version and you like Margot Cotten, you definitely want to go check her channel out, because you will hear a lot of CCR. So here we go. Margot Cotten, Who Will Stop the Rain?
Long as I remember, the rain been coming down. Clouds of mystery pouring, confusion on the ground. Coming through the ages, trying to find the sun. And I wonder, who'll stop the rain? I went down Virginia, seeking shelter from the storm.
There she was, Margot Cotten, with her cover of Who Will Stop the Rain. Again, CCR, constantly hearing their music. I remember that one. I want to say it was either like a Goodyear, Firestone, something. It was a tire company. I remember that. And that was a song for their commercials. So you still constantly are hearing CCR. Even today, you still hear their music from time to time on commercials and movies. It's timeless. It really is, and John Fogerty deserves a lot of credit for that. Next song up Around the Bend. And this one, guys, I feel like I'm on repeat here. Guess what year? 1970. Guess what album? Cosmos Factory. Guess who wrote it? John Fogerty. All that's the same. But Run Through the Jungle, if you remember that song by C.C.R, was the B-side of this one. This was released as a double single, double-sided single is what they called it. And this one peaked at number 4 on the Hot 100. The song, like many other C.C.R. songs, has been featured on movies, TV shows, covered by lots of artists, including a very young Elton John. Elton John actually covered this song. So let's listen to a little bit of Elton John's cover before we talk a little bit more about this. I think it'd be interesting for you guys to hear this. So kind of cool, right? A young Elton John doing a CCR cover. Very cool. But yeah, so that was Elton John. And today we've got Emmett Lee Stang doing it. And they have fun with it for sure. But in his memoir, Fortunate Son, My Life, My Music, John Fogerty said that this song came to him when he was riding his motorcycle through the California hills, giving a hint that as bad as things were in the early 70s, there might be some hope for the future. Things would improve just around the bend. This song did require, however, a little bit of translation for the British audience, because in England, if you go around the bend, it means you go crazy. So every time they'd go to England, John Fogerty would kind of have to explain to the crowd what in English terms, or American terms, I guess I should say, what around the bend actually meant here. So people weren't thinking he's talking about going crazy. So that's a little nugget on that one. Let's get to it though. Let's check it out. Like I say, Emmett Lee Stang is doing the cover and they have a really fun time doing this. And I'm good with that. I'm good when people have fun doing a video as long as they stay respectful to the music. And on this one, he absolutely does. So let's check it out. Here we go. Let's go up around the bend.
Behind.
All right, there was Emmett Lee Strang doing his version of Up Around the Bend. Like I said, seemed to have a lot of fun doing that. And I'm always impressed with artists that can do that. Margot, Cotten did it, and Emmett Lee Strang did it. Just people that can play multiple instruments. They play all the parts. They piece it together. Like, there's so much that goes into making those videos, guys. I'm telling you, because they've got to play each instrument all the way through. I'm sure they make mistakes, and then they got to replay it. Then they got to chop it all up, put it all together, make it all, you know, seamless. And it's just, it's very cool. It's very cool when I see people that do that and can do it very good. So props there to Margot and to Emmett for doing those covers. I talked about how the B-side, I guess, of that single was Run Through the Jungle. So I figured, well, what the hell, why not? Let's Run Through the Jungle. So we're going to play Run Through the Jungle, a cover. And doing the cover on this one is Big Bay Sound. Really good band also. But let's talk a little bit more about Run Through the Jungle. I've already told you who wrote it. I already told you what album it was on, what year it was released, what it ranked, all that. But here we go. This is yet, again, another one where many listeners misinterpreted this as being a protest song to the Vietnam War. However, in a 2016 interview, Fogerty said the song was actually about gun control. He said he remembered reading that there was one gun for every man, woman, and child in America, which he found staggering. So somewhere in the song, you can hear Fogerty say 200 million guns are loaded. So he just thought it was disturbing that it was such a jungle for citizens to walk around in our country with so many private guns owned by some responsible and maybe some many irresponsible people. And that's what the song was about. This also was Tom Fogerty's favorite song. So, did not know that. So, I might not agree with John Fogerty on gun rights, but I get what he's at least had the passion to write about it. And but it's just funny because, again, people instantly jumped to it and thought, protest song for Vietnam War. No, it was not. It was about just gun control in the United States. So, it is what it is. But here we go. Let's get to it. Big Bay Sound doing their cover of Run Through the Jungle. Thank you. All right, that was Big Bay Sound. I hope you guys enjoyed their rendition of Run Through the Jungle. I know I did. Next up, Fran Banish is the cover artist. And this guy, this is like just a true musician. Like, you can just tell this guy's a true artist. I don't know. Maybe he came from a band. I didn't look up his background as much, but he's definitely a legit artist. Okay, so this is going to be a great cover. He's doing a song that I really like a lot by C.C.R. And another one that made it to number 2 in the United States. And this came off of, the same album, Cosmos Factory. This was released in July 25th of 1970. And Fogerty stated that the song is about the loner in me, wanting to feel understood, needing those at home to shine a light so that he can make his way back. Slipknot singer Corey Taylor said that if you're on tour a lot, it's one of those songs that just makes you miss home when you hear it. So kind of cool to think of Slipknot listening to some CCR while they're on the road. But that's what I mean. CCR, just they are absolutely a very respected band. By all genres. I just talked about how Garth Brooks and Dwight Yoakam did a cover, and Elton John did a cover, and now you got Slipknot talking about listening to their music on the tour bus. So, I mean, it just tells you the gravity of CCR's music and just how far it reaches. Fogerty recorded a new version of this song with his rock band My Morning Jacket for his 2013 album, which was called Wrote a Song for Everyone. The remake was recorded at Blackbird Studios in Nashville on May 2nd, 2012. But what we're going to do is we're going to listen to Fran Banish do his cover. And I'm telling you guys, true artist, awesome song. What more can we ask for? Let's check it out right now, Long As I See the Light.
I feel like I got to move.
All right, that was Mr. Fran Banish, and he did mention that he did get to jam with John Fogerty back a while back, years ago. So I think he's connected to somebody, and so I'll announce it right now. Next week, I will be releasing a new episode of Spotlight, the regular Spotlight show, where we focus on cover artists. And I'm going to be doing a episode on Fran Banish. So I want to learn more about the guy. Like I say, super talented. Definitely feels like he's got a background in music somewhere. So we're going to check out more music by Fran Banish. So if you like that, you're definitely going to want to tune in next week and catch the Spotlight show that we do on him. So glad I can announce that right now. And again, if you guys are not subscribed to either of the channels that we are on, I would highly recommend it so you don't miss any upcoming shows. Again, real quick, it's YouTube. Just go search Heavy Hitter Network, or on Rumble, search HHNetwork, and you will find our channels. Click the subscribe button, and then you'll get emailed every time we release a new episode of a show. So very easy to do, and I would definitely appreciate it. All right, that takes us to the last song of the night before we get to the bonus video. And I'm telling you, you're definitely going to want to stick around for the bonus video. Very, very cool stuff. But one more song. So what one is this? Well, this was released in January of 1970. And it was called Travellin' Band. This was the first single released off of the Cosmos Factory album. And it was also the first single released following Fortunate Son. So Fortunate Son, of course, big success there, and this kind of had to follow that up. Fortunate Son, of course, came off Willie and the Poor Boys album. This was the first song off of the Cosmos Factory. So probably a lot of anticipation with that. And then when you think about it, because Willie and the Poor Boys album, very big album too, but for CCR to follow that up with the Cosmos Factory, just crazy how you can just follow that stuff up. So a lot of talent with John Fogerty. Like I say, in the small window that they really had, where they were really cranking out the tunes, to be Hall of Fame and this long-standing music that was written and created by this band is absolutely amazing. This song, number two. It was number two. And what was number one? What if I said it was Bridge Over Troubled Water by Simon and Garfunkel? Simon and Garfunkel keeping CCR off the top of the charts. Are you kidding me right now? No, I'm not. That was the song. The lyrics of the song describe what life is like for a musician on the road. The opening line, 7:30, 7 coming out of the sky, although he seems a little more aggressive than that, refers to the Boeing 737. Then coming into service on short to medium range routes. The song did have some controversy as there was a lawsuit by the company that held the publishing rights to Little Richard's Good Golly Miss Molly. They felt that the CCR had plagiarized the song and did end up settling out of court. Other criticism came, and this is an odd one too, from others that felt CCR had copied the Monkees' 1967 song, No Time. So I'm going to get on here right now, and I'm going to play for you all three songs and let you guys decide, was there plagiarism? And I honestly believe, honestly to me, I think the Monkees song sounds closer to Travellin' Band than Good Golly Miss Molly. So Good Golly Miss Molly, you've almost got to listen to the music, and that's kind of where they feel like CCR kind of copied the music of Good Golly Miss Molly. But it's the lyrics, not word for word, but just the delivery of the lyrics between the Monkees and CCR. But I'm telling you, I do get it. I understand why there was definitely some controversy about it. But I thought it'd be cool to kind of just play it, let you guys decide. So let's check that out real quick. And then we're going to go right into the cover, which actually this song too, I did want to mention, another one that Elton John covered. Another one. So Elton John covered two CCR songs. But let's check out the controversy, and then we'll get into the song. Doing the cover on this one, the Bazagas.
Hobasoven, Hobasiva snack. Siva rabber, Hobasoven, what did you expect?
737 coming out of the sky. Oh, won't you take me down to Memphis on a midnight ride? I won't move. Hey, you need a traveling pain. Yeah, well, I'm flying across the land. Try to get a ham. Hey, you need a traveling pain.
Good golly, Miss Molly.
The Bazaga's there rocking it out with their cover of Travellin' Band. I love that song. Again, another classic by C.C.R, but really, really good song. And they did a great job with that one. So they did exactly how you would want that song done. They kept it aggressive. Instruments were right on point. So really, really good job there. Bazaga's, if you like them, go check them out on YouTube for sure. Go support them. All right, time for the bonus video. And tonight, it's two. It's a twofer. It is the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame induction and the speech by the band, including John Fogerty. And I'm telling you, back when this happened, this was a very stressful situation for everybody involved, because of all the drama that had gone on over the years with John Fogerty's fallout with the band. And they still have not made up. I mean, this was not like, okay, we're going to get back together. No, they were not doing that. They at least all agreed to be present for the Hall of Fame. But yeah, there was no love loss here with any of this. So kind of a shame, because you would like to think that they could have put their differences aside and gotten back together at some point because of all the great music, but it just wasn't meant to be. It just was not meant to be. So, unfortunately, they didn't. But inducting them was Bruce Springsteen. And then, so we're going to get that first. We're going to first cue that up. And then we're going to go right into the band giving their thanks at the Hall of Fame. And, of course, Tom could not be there. He passed away at this time. So his son, I believe his name is Jeff, if I'm not mistaken, was there receiving the award for them. But yeah, it was a little just a little odd to me. I mean, when you see it, you can definitely feel, I think, some tension. I don't think I'm reading anything into that when I say you can feel it, you can see it, you can almost even hear it. But they all made it through, and it was good. But definitely a time in history for this band that I think got a lot of people's attention. So that's how we're going to finish it tonight. So I want to thank you guys again for tuning in. Definitely do your due diligence that I ask. Share the videos. Tell your friends. Tell your family members. Tell your enemies that the Heavy Hitter Network is back. Let them know Spotlight Tributes are back. Let them know Into the Lion's Den are back. Who You Got are back. Spotlight are back. We're back. And we're on YouTube and on Rumble. So you get to choose where you want to go get the videos from. And I'm just happy that you guys are definitely enjoying them and checking them out again. So that's going to do it. Again, check all the social media contacts in the description box below the video if you want to reach out to me. I would love that. Also, you can always hit me up on email, heavyhitterspodcast@gmail.com. You can also call the hotline, 1-616-258-6386. It's also an option for you to have your voice heard, get your opinions out there. If you guys have a suggestion for an upcoming Spotlight or Spotlight Tribute series, by all means, let me know. All right, thank you, everybody. Have a good night and enjoy the bonus footage. Starting in 3, 2, 1.
Thanks. In 1970, suburban New Jersey was still filled with the kind of 60s spirit Easy Rider made us all so fond of. I'm referring to the scene where Dennis Hopper gets blown off his motorcycle by some redneck with a shotgun. A weekend outing at the time was still filled with the drama of possibly getting your ass kicked by a total stranger who disagreed with your fashion sense. Me and my band worked on Route 35 outside Asbury Park at a club called the Pandemonium. They'd recently lowered the drinking age to 18 with the logic that if you were old enough to die, you were old enough to drink. And so it was 5 50-minute sets a night, and rarely a night without a fight. The crowd was eclectic. Rough kids just out of high school who hadn't been snatched up by the draft yet. Truck drivers heading home south into the Jersey Pines who weren't going to make it, not that night at least. And a mixture of college and working girls, women with bouffant hairdos, and a small but steady hippie contingent. Tough crowd to please all at once. We played behind a U-shaped bar that was just 3 feet in spitting distance from many of the patrons who came to just drink and stare and hassle a band. Into New Jersey came the music of John and Tom Fogerty, Doug Clifford, and Stu Cook, Creedence Clearwater Revival. And for the 3 minutes and 7 seconds of Proud Mary, a very strained brotherhood would actually fill a room. It was simply a great song everybody liked, and it literally saved our asses on many occasions. But Creedence started off in the long jamming tradition of other San Francisco bands, realized it wasn't their road, quit cold, and went on to great things. Green River, Bad Moon Rising, Down on the Corner, Lodi, Fortunate Son, Who'll Stop the Rain, Born on the Bayou. Wasn't only great music, it was great dance music, it was great bar band music. I remember in the late 70s, I'd be out in the club and I'd watch some band struggle through one of my songs and then just kind of glide effortlessly through a Creedence Clearwater tune. You know, it used to really piss me off. But anyway, I stand here tonight still envious of that music's power and its simplicity. And they were hits, and hits filled with beauty and poetry and a sense of the darkness of events and of history, of an American tradition shot through with pride, fear, paranoia, and they rocked hard. Now, you can't talk about Creedence without talking about John Fogerty. On the fashion front, all of Seattle should bow. I give you... You know, John was the father of the flannel shirt. And as a songwriter, only few did as much in 3 minutes. He was Old Testament, shaggy-haired prophet, fatalist, funny too. As Clint Eastwood said, a man's got to know his limitations. But I can say I've never met anybody who took him so seriously. You know, he was severe, he was precise, he said what he had to say and got out of there. He was lyrically spare and beautiful. He created a world of childhood memory and of men and women back to the wall. Landscape of swamps, bayous, endless rivers, gypsy women, back porches, hound dogs chasing ghosts, devils, bad moons rising, straight out of the blues tradition. He turned it into a vision that was all his own. And in Doug, Stu, and Tom, he had the band that could back it up. What makes a great rock band is a funny thing. It's not always the obvious things. You can't ever really know what makes a great band tick. It's not about what the players are exactly like. All I know is you had Tom Fogerty's relentless rhythm guitar and Doug and Stu's great rhythm section and John's songwriting and singing. And all I know is they played great together. I bumped into John one day up on Mulholland Drive and we laughed about how far he was from the bayou and I was from the New Jersey Turnpike. So, Creedence made music for all the waylaid Tom Sawyers and Huck Finns, and for a world that would never again be able to take them up on their most simple and eloquent invitation, which was if you get lost, to come on home to Green River. So let me end by saying, in their day, Creedence never got the respect they deserved. Who would have thought in 69 that before the Grateful Dead, Jefferson Airplane, Moby Grape, Strawberry Alarm Clock, or Electric Prunes, Creedence would be inducted into a Rock and Roll Hall of Fame if there was going to be one. They committed the sin of being too popular when hitness was all. They played no-frills American music for the people. In the late 60s and early 70s, they weren't the hippest band in the world, just the best. So let me, yeah. Anyway, so let me finish by saying congratulations, men, to a job well done. And to all the naysayers, ha, 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 they told you so. So, Doug Clifford, Stu Cook, Jeff Fogerty accepting for his dad, John Fogerty, congratulations. And induction into the Hall of Fame.
Well, nobody wants to go first, so guess what? It's me. I can't really begin to describe the feeling that I feel inside at this moment, so I won't try. What I'll do is I'll thank a lot of people, and I'm going to do it chronologically. Somewhat of a historical. I was a history major in college for a while. So, first of all, I want to start by thanking Tom Fogerty. I miss him. And Tom is the one that got the rest of us in a recording studio when we were 15 years old, backing him up, trying to get a record deal. So he was way ahead of his time. Demo tapes now are, of course, guys at the gas station you drive in, they have their demo tapes. Nobody had a demo tape in 1959. So, Tom, thank you for that. I know you're here. I want to thank John Fogerty for sharing his immense talents. I want to thank Stu Cook for his solid bass playing and his friendship for 34 years. I want to thank Fantasy Records for putting our records out when no other label in the world was interested in Creedence Clearwater Revival. I want to thank disc jockeys around the world for playing us then, breaking the band, and for continuing to play the music today. I hear it all the time on the radio. I want to thank our fans. That's an obvious one. None of this would be happening if people didn't love us, and we love all of you, whoever you are, wherever you are. I want to thank the Hall of Fame nominating committee for thinking of us, and I want to thank everyone who voted for us and everyone who didn't vote for us. What the hell? I can take it. I I have some things that I want to say about the future, and I want to thank Mr. Cliff Bernstein for putting the SDQ, formerly Sir Douglas Quintet, together with Elektra Records' Nonsuch label. I want to thank Bob Krasnow for his support, Nancy Jeffries for her diligent work, and look out and around summertime, there's going to be a great rock and roll band with some young people mixed in with it. They wanted to call it the best of young and old, and you know what that made me, so I prefer to call it the best of youth and experience. And of course, most importantly, I want to thank my family over here, my son Brent, my son Grady, my daughter Jamie, my wife of 25 years, who was with me when we were in the Blue Velvets in high school sweetheart. We've been together 31 years. My wife, Lori.
First, I gotta say, this is really awesome and very humbling. As you know, I've been kind of part of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame for a few years, and really never expected to be standing here. It's really, well, hey, can you dig it? This is really cool. as you know, I usually got up and had something prepared because I was speaking for someone else, but my wife always tells me to speak from the heart, so I'll kind of do it off the cuff. First of all, I just want to thank the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame people for making this possible. I'm blown away by it. I think we all are. I'd also like to thank my former bandmates, Doug and Stu and Tom. We've disagreed a lot over the years, but there was a time when we made really great music together. And I think that's actually the whole reason, that's the real deal why we're here at all. So thank you guys. I'd like to thank my brother Bob, who's been with me through thick and thin. Those of you that know me well know that there's been some thin, and we're looking forward to some thick. Thank you, Bo, for a lifetime of service, actually. And I guess I should talk about influences. So I'll just bring it down to one. I've got a new influence in my life right now, and it's my beautiful wife, Julie. And Julie, I just want to tell you, I love you more than the sky. And thank you for being the joy of my life. And finally, I really want to thank all the fans and the people who have backed this music for whatever it is that you find in there. I'm sure glad you do. And I always enjoy hearing the stuff on the radio and seeing people come up wishing us well. It's a great feeling, and God bless you all. Thank you.
Good evening. Wow, this is, as Sean said, awesome. It's, you know, when we started playing down in the music room of my folks' house, we had no idea that it would ever end up in something like this, that there would ever even be this kind of recognition for the music that we love so much. You know, as we sat there listening and learning from records, the artists that we loved, copying every note, I mean, that was the whole goal then. Then came the goal of maybe one night we'll earn $100 each. And then the phone kept ringing off the hook, and I guess the rest is sort of more than geography, you know. I mean, this is a worldwide thing. The Hall of Fame is more than the people inducted in it. It really is about the fans, because if it wasn't for the people that love the music, there would be no reason for all of this. So I really have to thank all of the Creedence fans, the old ones and the new ones that are coming along, picking up their folks' CDs, LPs, tapes. I'd like to thank my folks for encouraging me and my wife for putting up with me, Laura. Thank you, babe. It's been some crazy times. I'd like to thank my bandmates, John, Tom. Tonight would have been a big night for Tom, and I know he's there with us. I got to thank my partner, Kaz. Outside of Al Jackson and Duck Dunn, I can't think of anybody else I'd rather listen to than me and Kaz. Really, folks. When it comes to rhythm sections, I'm particular. Jack and Ginger. I mean, there's some classic ones, but I know Doug and I are like a hand in a glove. I'd like to thank the Hall of Fame for thinking of the four of us. I know that that it means a lot. It really does. I'd like to thank the people at Fantasy Records for being there when we needed it at the beginning, buying an amp, paying for the first album, getting the door open. You know, a lot of stuff's gone under the bridge since then, but they were there when it counted. And thank you all for being here tonight. Have a big old time, huh?
I'm very proud and honored to accept this award from my father. I know he would have really liked to have been here tonight and would have got a great kick out of being here. I'm sure if he was here, he would like to thank the guys in the band, Stu and Doug and John, for all the time and music that they made together, because this is where they ended up. I'm sure he'd also like to thank the record company for giving them a shot and an opportunity to make the records, and it took off on its own. And Dad, wherever you are, Trish, the kids, me, the family, we all love you and we miss you. And this one's for you, pal.